Starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
So hello, welcome, welcome. This is Karina Gordon-Barnes, and you are absolutely in the right place for this webinar about how to set good, solid, healthy prices and not drop them. That's the key as well. Not just setting them, but actually sticking with them when you're having conversations with prospective clients. Wonderful that you're here. This can really be a minefield, this area of pricing, for so many self-employed men and women. So we're going to look today at making the whole experience of pricing much easier and much more peaceful. That is my intention for us today. We're here together for a precious 90 minutes, and I would like to get to know you a little bit and interact with you. For those of you who've been saying hello already, it's been great to see you there. Do type in and let me know where in the world you are and what is your passion. So by that second question, I mean, what are you selling and what is that product or service that you're wanting to set a price for? So I'll put those questions up for you. Where are you and what is your passion? What are you actually pricing? And I love to interact with people during these webinars. And to do this, I'll use your first name. So I'll say things like, Joe has a great question, or Sam makes a fantastic point. If you don't want me to do that, if you don't want me to refer to you by your first name, please type in, when you type in, also type in, don't use my name in capitals. Otherwise, I'm going to assume that you are fine with that. And while you're doing that, I'll let you know a little bit about me. I went self-employed as an English tutor. So I was home tutoring kids in their homes in Cambridge back in 2004. So 10 years I've been self-employed. And then I trained as a coach in 2005. So for 10 years, I've been finding my own clients. I've been finding my own salary. I've been connecting with the people who I most want to help and who want to pay me, who want to keep me in business and get my support. And throughout that time, I've changed my business model, changed the kind of way that I offer services, certainly changed my prices. And we've had a global recession during that time. And I've been paid consistently throughout. And I've seen that this hasn't happened for everybody. And I believe that it's because we're often not taught how to price and how to stick with our prices once they are set. So that's what I'm here for today, to bring clarity and comfort to this whole area of pricing. Okay, so let's see where we've got participants from today and what kind of products and services you are offering to the world. Hey to Anne, hey Victoria, hey Kay, hey Janice, hey Katie, hey Lindsay, hey Ella, hey Amanda, hey Stephanie, hey Beverly, hey Emma, hey Carla, hey Jane. Wonderful. So we've got your passion is to help project managers reach success easily and effectively. Hey Hila, great to have you here. I saw your name and got very excited. So Janice, you're doing coaching and HR solutions. Anne is getting small business owners to use and be successful with her online appointment management software. We've got London, we've got Spain. Wonderful. We've got Suffolk, Warwickshire, Herefordshire, more in London, quite a few of you are in London right now. Great, Victoria, you're doing photography, specializing in newborns, wonderful. Acupuncture, hey Carla, Carla in London. Wonderful, Kay, you're nearby me in Cambridge. Let's see, yeah, great. So Ella, you're offering holidays with therapy. Fantastic, great to have you here. We've got Lindsay with wall art. Fantastic, we've got Surrey. We've got more therapy, social work, Shropshire. Lovely, it's great to get a sprinkling of where people are and what it is you're doing. So So you're all so welcome today. Here's how it's going to be running. And this is as you other people are joining. Welcome, welcome. Do type in where you are and what your passion is. So here's how we're going to run the webinar today. I'm going to be sharing with you a pre-recorded training. Here it is here. There's the play button right there. I'm going to be sharing that with you today. So you're going to be seeing the slides. You're going to be hearing my voice on the recording. And at the same time, because it's a recording, I can read everything you write in. So type in your insights as we go, and I can read everything. So it's like you're getting two of me. You're getting the training from me, and you've got my eyes on everything that you're saying. I won't be typing in back to you because, as we've discovered, it actually makes a noise when I do this. So it's not ideal to do that because people then can't hear. But I will be reading everything. And then when we come to questions, I'll have a sense of your, have a sense of the journey that you've taken with this webinar. And that's going to make it easier to answer your questions. And even with the two of me, I am still not going to be able to share everything that I want to about this topic and about related topics. So I will then move on after we've gone through that training and you've hopefully taken massive aha moments and insights and life is feeling very different. I'll then move in to let you know about a training course that is available to you, and I'll walk you through it enough so that you can decide if you want to join, because we opened enrollment yesterday. And then whether it is the right time to take that next step with the course or not, do stick around for the final section of our time together, because that's where we'll have the questions. And I may even have time to be able to open up someone's line or maybe even a few people's lines if you want to share your voice and share your insights. And maybe we can also demo together. Just depends if we're going to have time today to do that. I can demo some of the exercises that I offer you in the training. So I'm here for the whole 90 minutes with you. Do stick around for all of that if you possibly can. Let me see people who've been joining. Hey, Felicity, welcome. Wonderful. Viable business models in gardening, planning, architectural design. Hey, Ellie, wonderful to have you here. Hey, Amanda. So good, we're here. This is how the time together is going to play out. But first, very, very importantly, this whole area of pricing can include quite a bit of fear and uncertainty. And there can be lots of doubts and lots of shakiness around this. So I want to start with connection. I want to start by prioritizing connection with a sense of unconditional safety. So I invite you to, wherever you are sitting, just to sit back or lie back or wherever you are, just come back in yourself and close your eyes if that's comfortable. And feel gravity anchoring you here. A sense of being tethered and grounded. And that there's nothing you have to do to create your own safety. That gravity is taking care of you right now. You're held, you're secure. You're not going anywhere. And then bringing your awareness to your breathing and watching the breath as if you were sitting at the edge of the sea, watching the waves coming in and going out. Noticing a sense of stillness. And again, a sense of unconditional safety, that there's absolutely nothing you have to do. Your breath is coming in regardless of your bank balance, regardless of your pricing, regardless of what people say about your pricing. You have gravity, you have your breath. And I invite you to imagine that your pricing comes always from this place of stillness. When you set your prices, when you speak your prices, when you handle conversations with people about your prices, it's always coming from this place of unconditional safety and stillness. And gently starting to wriggle your fingers, toes, bringing movement back into your body, stretching arms, legs, yawning, sighing. And when you're ready, just typing in to let me know how it was to have that connection. What did you experience? And what do you notice about how this place of stillness and unconditional safety might support you to price from here? Type in, let me know. And welcome to those of you who've joined us in the last few minutes. You're in the right place for this webinar about how to set good, solid prices and not drop them. Wonderful. I'm seeing relaxed, at ease. Yeah, pricing from here, being supported might feel easy. Who knew? Great. Let's see what others of you experienced in that connection. I'm curious if you've priced from here before or if this is really quite new. Hey, Betty. Great to have you here. Yeah, I'm reading a lot of people saying so calm, a sense of clarity, a sense of stillness. Wonderful. So we're going to start with the training. You'll hear that I refer a couple of times in the recording to this being a 60-minute training. It's because it was last time, but this is 90 minutes this time. So just ignore it when I refer to 60 minutes. And just ignore again if I say anything about yesterday or today, that won't necessarily be relevant to right now. But the content itself hasn't changed. So there was no need to redo it. It was exactly as I would share it with you today. So I'm sharing that so that I can then read everything you are typing in as we go through. Any questions, I can make a note of them as we go through. And keep talking with me in the typing and get pen and paper ready. And we'll go into the training now.
So it's really wonderful. You're all so welcome. And whether you're selling jewelry or health coaching or career coaching, or you're running My Body Spirit Festivals, whatever it is that you're selling, the pricing bit is often where people come unstuck. And it can really be quite a shock if you've been used to being employed. Self-employment and the whole part about pricing can be really daunting. Because when you're in employment, someone else sets your salary normally. You get pay slips, you put them in your folders like this. You kind of don't necessarily need to think too much about pricing. You don't have to engage in the same way as when you're running your own business. When you're running your own business, it can feel more like this. It can feel really quite hard, quite daunting. The whole area can feel really messy. And so it's all too common that we undercharge, that we set prices that are too low. And we know that they're too low because we feel resentful. You feel tight. You feel like you're barely able to cover your costs. You can't hire support. You can't take decent holidays. You can't relax as much as you feel you need to with all the great work that you're doing. just type in yes if any of this is sounding familiar to you. Maybe it's that you're okay with kind of setting them to start with, but then you find that you don't stick with them. So when it comes to a conversation with a prospective client, you notice that you drop the prices, you offer discounts, you offer concessions. And really, if pricing is a hard area for you, and if you're struggling with the money side, for me, that's really not okay. Even if money is not your primary motive, you know, you're doing what you do because you want to help people, it's so important to me that it's sustainable for you, that you can keep doing this and that it feels good to keep doing this. So we're here really to break some of those patterns of underpricing and under-earning and struggling with this whole area. So today we're going to look at how to set and quote your prices with confidence. The most powerful way to handle those dreaded words, I can't afford it, and how to help more people say yes to your rates. So my intention overall is to just demystify and simplify this whole area of pricing. We've got 60 minutes together. There's so much more I could say about all this. Towards the end, I'm going to let you know a bit more about how you can get more from me if you get to the end and you're like, right, I want more. So we're going to start with the level of beliefs. Many of us weren't taught the beliefs of being a business owner, so we can get a bit stuck. What I want to happen, you'll see on your dashboard, there's a little image where you can actually raise your hand. It's got a little hand icon. I invite you to raise your hand if you can identify with this belief that I'm now putting on the screen. This belief that money is tight and people aren't spending. So just raise your hand if you have either thought this yourself or if you've heard it from somebody else. So maybe somebody that you were trying to sell something to or just with your colleagues. Yeah, great. Not everybody, but there are quite a few hands. Yeah, lots of yellow hands going up on my screen here. So I've definitely heard it. You know, it's a recession. It's the economy is contracted. You know, type in, let me know if there's other versions of that you've heard. You know, it's out of my budget. Our budget's been shrunk. So if we believe these kind of things, if we come from this perspective, then our pricing decisions are going to align with this belief. They're going to flow from these beliefs. So here's a story of how I moved away from this belief. You might recognize this place. This is in London. I was actually in London. It was a Saturday. I was coming to London for an event off Regent Street. And this is Selfridges. I had some time to spare. I thought, I haven't really walked around Selfridges. I'll go and have a walk around. And this was a day where that week I'd been hearing quite a bit about the economy and that money was really tight and people weren't spending. And I walked in the doors of Selfridges and was just overwhelmed by the amount of products and the amount of people that were buying, really enthusiastically buying lots of things. So you walk into Selfridges, there's the perfume, there's the handbags, there's the scarves, there's the jewelry. And what I really was struck by, it was a very visceral experience. What I was struck by was that even in a time of recession, even when it is true that for many people times are hard, there will always be some people who have lots of money and lots of people who have some money. And this is not just in London and it's not just for certain products or services. Really, we see it across the board. So I feel that when we say people can't afford something, we're actually diminishing their resourcefulness. We're not actually doing them justice. And there's an activity that I set on one of the courses that I teach, which I call the 5-minute shopping center method. I know Juzi, who's here, was on that course. You'll know this activity, Juzi. It's where I invite you, and I really do invite you to actually do this, to go and spend time in either a shopping center, a big department store, a mall, you know, just a regular high street. And just sit and watch the flow of money all around you. Just sit there and watch that people are spending and seeing how easy it is that people are spending or their bags that they're taking. Because this is going to help with this this positive belief cycle that I would love for you to have. to play with, which is, it starts with this. This is the first belief in this sequence. Your passion is no accident. So all of those things that you're sharing with me that you're passionate about, it's not just random that you have that passion. It's because you've either seen and heard a need out there and your passion is to help with that need. It's because you've done market research and you've heard that there's a need. Or it's just an instinct. You just really feel called, drawn to do the work that you do. Okay, so that's not accidental. Okay, so that's the first part of the belief cycle. The second part is that people are willing to act to get their needs met. How do we know that this is true? Well, if it weren't true, then people just wouldn't leave the house, right? People buy things, they reach out for help every day. Otherwise, nobody would make it to the doctors, to the food shop, to the shoe shop. When we need something, we act, and you can just see that this is true for yourself. So you felt the need to look at this area of pricing, so you're willing to act. You're willing to put aside an hour, jump on the computer with me. This is just what we do. Then the third in this positive belief cycle is that people are willing to spend money to get their needs met. It's the natural follow-on from being willing to act. And again, we can sit in the shopping center in the high street and we can see that this is true. And so then let's close this loop. Well, why not with you? Because your passion is no accident. So you see this cycle goes round. So I'm going to leave that with you while I just flick through the comments that have been coming in just to see if there's anything that I need to look at there. Hey to all the people who've joined me recently. Yeah, lots of people saying that they did or they were having those kind of beliefs around that the there is no money to go around. So I'm hoping that you find this cycle of beliefs. You see how it really naturally goes around. The more you can think this, the more your pricing then comes from this new set of beliefs. And what's really important is that you're then pricing what you do as a solution to a need. So remember, people act to meet needs, they pay to meet needs. So just feel free now to type in, even if I don't see it, just for your own benefit of expressing it, what is the need that your product, your service is meeting? And sometimes people say, well, it doesn't really meet a need. It's art or it's luxury. It doesn't really meet a need. So I encourage you to think outside the box of needs as being kind of survival needs. We're not talking about you need it to live, to kind of, this is not bread and butter and the house over your head. What I would encourage you to think about is that everybody has a need to feel a certain way, to honor their values. And my most recent epiphany around this is that we all have a need, I think, to tell stories about ourselves, to ourselves and to others, about who we are, about who we want to be. So start thinking about, well, what story does my product meet the need for in someone? What does it say about them? So let's take Charlotte, because Charlotte, I know that we had a short conversation about this. You know, what story does that person get to create about themselves when they buy your party service, your home event service? The story that they tell themselves, the story that they tell other people. It's a really incredibly powerful way to look at positioning what you do. People aren't buying the thing. They're buying the story that you give them access to. So I invite you to delete this belief. It's not helpful. So sometimes people also then think, okay, so I'm going to stop undercharging. Instead, I'm going to do this. I'm going to hold my head up high and I'm going to charge what I'm worth. So again, just type in if you have identified this belief for yourself, if you have heard something similar in yourself or others. I know that when I trained as a coach, I was told, charge as high as you can until you feel sick. And someone else I heard said, I charge as high as I can until someone laughs at me. So it's kind of this slight vertigo feeling of like, just go as high as like, whoa. So yes, we're going to look at how it's great to find the highest price that feels really good for you. But the piece that I want to unpick here is that that doesn't mean that that price is what you're worth. I actually find that whole piece around worth to be really demeaning and actually quite insulting. And there's a story that really kind of hit this for me. You might recognize this character. It's Charlotte in Sex and the City. You might well know the story better than I do. It was a long time ago that I watched it, but this scene really stuck with me. She is marrying a rich guy, and there's a prenup that she's signing. And it says something like she'll get, I don't know, $500,000 if they divorce, she'll get $500,000. And she's not happy with this, and she's kind of worrying about it. And then there's this scene where supposedly she becomes really empowered, and she stands at the doorway, and she kind of flicks her hair and says, I'm worth $1,000,000. And I'm like, really? Is that all you think you're worth? You know, I think any amount, doesn't matter if it's millions, billions, anything, it actually diminishes our value. You know, we are inherently worthy. People aren't buying us. You're not for sale. People aren't buying the value, the worth of you. And so when we get into this kind of because I'm worth it kind of thing, for me, that misses the point of being in relationship. It kind of has this energy like I'm a queen, I'm a king, I'm an empress, and I might lower myself to help others, but they kind of have to bow or prostrate themselves and give money to me. They're kind of lucky to have me. For me, that doesn't work, and if it hasn't been working for you, then this might be kind of a real light bulb moment. And it doesn't work for me because a business relationship is a relationship. So if I went into a romantic relationship with this kind of hair flicking, I'm worth it, and it's just not, I don't think it's going to feel very fulfilling. It's not going to feel very equal. It's not going to feel very heart to heart. So I invite you to see it differently. When it comes to the money transaction, here's what I see. I see that you are not for sale. People aren't buying you. What's actually happening is that your gifts, which we've seen are no accident, they are flowing through you to others. So your creativity, your ideas, your care, your skills, your attention, all of that is flowing through you and out of you to help others. I just love this image. And then what's happening is as you're giving your gifts, the other person, your client, is actually standing there before you, and their money is flowing through them to you. It's not even their money, it's just money. Money is flowing through them to you. It's an energy. So a financial transaction is actually about being in relationship, being heart to heart, and keeping those channels open. So yes, go as high as feels good with your pricing, and we're going to look at how to do that in a moment. All that means is that you're holding the channels as wide open as you can. But it's not about your worth. Please don't ever think that. It diminishes, it actually shrinks you. It's going to take a moment to take a sip and see anything else that's been coming in. Yeah, wonderful. People have been sharing the need that your services meet, the need for self-expression, to move forward. Wonderful. The need for meaning, the need for an improved immune system. Yeah. Wonderful. Really wonderful to see you kind of engaging and feeling how this fits. You know, try all this on, see how it fits for you. So actually setting the prices then, I encourage you to use your instinct. I encourage you to think of yourself like Goldilocks. We're actually finding the price that is not too low. Okay, that it feels scratchy and it feels resentful, and also not too high, that you're flicking your hair around and feeling out of relationship with other people. We're looking for just right pricing. Just right pricing that feels good, that you don't have to justify, you don't have to explain, you don't have to kind of translate it into a value. Okay, so we're not even talking about it being worth it to the other person. Can you see this is actually quite revolutionary? It's not just that you're not worth anything, but it's that you can't you can't put a number on what it's worth to somebody else. It's not about that. We go back again to that image. This transaction is like this. Okay, so to find that just right pricing, very practically, do this by writing down the lowest number that you could possibly imagine someone paying you, and then write down the highest number that you could possibly imagine someone paying you. And then take that into a meditation, into just a quiet, calm sitting with the numbers, and work your way up or down the numbers, kind of sounding those numbers out for yourself and asking, does this feel right? Does this feel resonant? Or does it jar? Does it kind of niggle at you? Does it not, it doesn't feel quite right? So here's how I explained this pricing method to my mum. So we were down, I was walking with her down in Dorset, and I was explaining that I teach my clients how to set really healthy prices and not drop them, not discount them. And she said, but isn't discounting good? You know, isn't that what people do? And I said, right, how can I explain what I mean by this resonant pricing? And she was walking her dog, Bungle, a beautiful black Labrador. I said, right, mum, tell me what colour is Bungle? She kind of looked at me like, oh my gosh, what are you talking about? Well, he's a black Labrador. I said, right, how does that feel? And she said, well, it feels true. That's what he is. He's a black Labrador. I said, great. Now try saying Bungle is a brown Labrador. And she said, well, I can't. It's not true. And this is how I have found pricing to be, that when you settle on a price, and it does feel like really settling, really sinking into a price, it just feels right. You couldn't then say another price if you were to discount it. And you might now realize that this is why discounts and kind of in the moment dropping your prices have felt wrong, because it's been like you're lying. It's like there was a price that was true, and then you dropped it to a different price and it wasn't true anymore. It jarred. It was like looking at that beautiful dog and saying it's brown. Well, he's not. So let's just have you have the chance to practice this right now. I want to give you the chance to practice matter-of-fact pricing, either by speaking out loud. No one's going to hear you. You're all on mute. Or by typing in. What I would love you to do is to type or speak. I would encourage you to type, because I like to read the answers. To type a few things that you see in your surroundings. So we're looking for matter-of-fact energy. Okay, we're not looking for any kind of spike. You see that heart monitor. We're not looking for a heart spike. We're just looking for facts. So I would type, there's a bottle of water on my desk. There's a key on my shelf by the window. There's a bunch of pink flowers on my windowsill. Okay, so just facts. And just notice there's no question mark in your voice, in your energy. No justification. And then you just add in prices. Okay, so it just becomes the same factual, no drama, no apology, no question mark kind of energy. Okay, so I would type in my mobile phone is on the left. I have a mug of elderflower tea here. The price of the Blog for Clients course is $495. There's a picture of me and my wife on the right-hand side of me. Okay, so you notice there's no emotion. It's not an emotive experience. Your price is just factual. So just be doing this now. I like to have a little kind of a glimpse into your world and to see. We had some paisley pajamas yesterday, and we had people's cats in the scenery. So great, just exactly great, Nicholas. Out Tigger's fantastic. Yeah, hey Corinne. Yeah. Wonderful. So you're just typing facts about your scenario, and then you're just putting a price in. If you haven't yet set a price, just put in something, and you'll notice very quickly if it doesn't feel right. It will just feel, oh, that's not the right price. Yeah, great. So fantastic. You're typing in those prices with the same matter-of-fact energy. And as you keep doing this, just really noticing how it feels, and let me know how it might feel different from how you have quoted your prices before. Because if you think about when you go to a shop and there's price tags on the items of clothing, imagine what it would feel like if there was a question mark on those price tags. You know, just let me know, think about how would you feel? How would that question mark make you feel? Okay, I like it when there's no question mark, when I hear a price or when I see a price, because it feels matter of fact. It doesn't feel emotive, it doesn't feel personal. It feels solid, it feels calm, and it feels really reliable and really safe. It really instills confidence in me as the potential customer. Yeah, wonderful. Really lovely to see these prices coming in. Yeah, practicing with a question mark, seeing how the question mark feels different. Great, wonderful. So Corinne just typed something, and then she typed something else with a question mark, and then she said, actually, yeah, that feels good. Yeah, wonderful. Oh, great. This is great. Nicola's actually typing in some facts about how much things are costing her. That's a really great example, Nicola. The factualness of when you actually pay for something. Notice that you didn't have a question mark there. I'm going to include that when I run this exercise in the future. Great, Heather. Yeah, great, Sal. Wonderful. So keep doing that. Keep feeling. And, you know, after this session, keep noticing how it feels. I had someone when I gave this as a talk, she emailed me the next day and said, I kept talking to my plants and telling them prices. And she was able in that next conversation that she had with a client to state her price without a question mark. And he said yes. And she actually got to help someone, she said, who was really in need. So for her, just this one exercise enabled her to help somebody in a way that she wouldn't have. I think she thinks she would have kind of botched that sale if she hadn't have practiced this kind of pricing. So I really would love to hear if something like that happens for you too. Wonderful. So I would love then for you to be able to delete and replace that belief about the worth and all of that. Just take the question mark out and stay in relationship with the person. So we've been looking in this first section at how to set your prices. So using your intuition, going up the scale, feeling like Goldilocks, looking for that just right price. And then we've been looking to quote them with confidence without a question mark. And now we move into these dreaded four words that we can hear as business owners. Just type in or, in fact, raise your hand if you have heard these words or if you have said these words, I can't afford it. I can't afford it. Yeah, lots of people, lots of hands. Are there any hands that haven't gone up? Yeah, there are some, but most people are saying, yep, I know that one. So what do we do when we hear those words? You know, it's quite normal for our heart to sink, for our kind of tummy to contract, panic, to drop our prices because somebody is in effect saying no to us and it can feel like a form of rejection. So it's really natural that we would want to try to find a way to make the person say yes, and we think that dropping the price is the answer. I want you to just imagine what would happen in these scenarios if someone said, I can't afford it. So in a bakery, someone says, I'd like that bloomer, but I can't afford it. I'd like these pair of shoes, but I can't afford them. I would like that rug, that sofa, that light, but I can't afford it. Hopefully, what would happen is that the shop assistant would have empathy. They would say, I hear that. I really understand. And it doesn't mean that they would change the price. Okay, so the pricing decision has been made ahead of time. It feels right. And so I would invite you to spend some time this week practicing with someone or just practicing by yourself that idea of you and a shop assistant, you being the shop assistant, that you can hold empathy and at the same time stay firm so that you really show that you mean what you say. Your price is your price is your price is your price. And it just feels good. It feels okay. So once you're doing that and you can just be with that, I can't afford it, you can actually then do something really powerful, which is that you can translate what is really being said when someone says, I can't afford it. Because once you know what is really being said, you know what to do about it. So I'm going to share three ways that you can translate those words, I can't afford it, kind of keep them in your back pocket and employ them with that empathy and with that solidity of pricing. So the first translation, the first way that I would like you to kind of filter those words is that you hear that it's just simply not a financial priority for that person. So it's not that they can't afford it. If it was absolutely a top priority for them, you know, we've all probably known people who have sold their houses to be able to afford something, or, you know, sold all their worldly belongings and traveled across the world because that was more important to them. So we're very resourceful with money. We can make things happen. I had a friend who was really keen to do a training course. She was telling me about it, but telling me she couldn't afford it. A couple of weeks, months later, she'd booked a holiday to Thailand. So it wasn't that she couldn't afford the course. It was that for her right now, it just wasn't her priority. And again, like, reflect just for yourself. You know, you've done this probably. I certainly have. I've said I can't afford it, but I really just mean I actually would rather spend the money somewhere else. And that could be you'd rather spend your money on rent. Okay, it doesn't have to be a holiday. But that is more true than I can't afford it. So the remedy for this is to get clear in your mind and in your communication that it is a priority issue. It's an allocation of resources issue. The person is absolutely within their right, and it's perfectly okay that they are deciding to spend their money elsewhere. But what's really important for you is that you leave the door open so they can come back in the future. And who I think does this really well is Apple. When I go into the Apple store, when I very first went in to buy my first of many Apple products, I tried to haggle, you know, I tried to say, well, you know, I'm going to buy two. Can I get a discount for this? And they were just completely unmoving. Just like, no, we don't do discounts. The price is the price is the price. We know this is a great product. And it actually really instilled confidence in me. And what I love about this image is that you can see that the doors really are opening. It's a very open door, kind of a shop, kind of a store. And so this is what you can inhabit, this idea that you are in it for the long game. You know, I have often said to people, if they've said I can't afford it, I say, hey, no worries, I get it. I'm not going anywhere. You know, come back when this is a priority for you. So you're giving the person responsibility and you're showing yourself to be really solid and really trustworthy, that what you say is what you mean. Now, one reason that it might not be a priority is this. Okay, so this is the second translation. That the value of what you're offering has not yet been communicated to the person who is considering buying. And the solution to this is my favorite thing, which is to get really, really amazing at marketing. So that you can tell that story, you know, that story of who the person wants to be. You tell that story to people through your marketing, so through blogs, through videos, through social media, through talks, through webinars, through teleclasses, however you do it, you tell the value, you sell the value, you sell the story before the price comes. The price is just then an afterthought. Okay, and the reason that this picture is of a woman at a computer is because we live in such exciting online marketing times, you know, really we can convey value so easily these days through things like blogging and social and videos. I'm going to get onto that more in a moment. So this is the remedy, to tell the story before expecting somebody to want to pay the price. Just going to just scroll and see how this is landing for people. Wonderful. Yeah, interesting. Fiona's saying, yeah, I look around and I spot that they're actually spending elsewhere. Yeah, Penelope's saying, I can relate to this. It's how I feel people may view buying jewellery, that it's not a priority. So, and I've actually bought jewellery from Penelope, so this is perfect. Think about what was the story that I was telling myself, that I was telling my partner when I bought her a pair of earrings from you, Penelope. It was that story that became a priority for me. It became a priority for me to tell that story. And I told that story through buying your jewelry. So, thank you, Marina. No, the art, thank you, Marina, saying this artwork is beautiful. The art is done by Joe, who is our creative director for my company. And on the blogging course that we're, I'm going to talk you through in a moment, she has designed all the images for all of the modules, and they're all kind of like this, basically. The beautiful images that you've been seeing are all from the blogging course. So yeah, it's amazing, huh? Wonderful. So the final translation to have there in your back pocket, that someone is actually saying, when they say I can't afford it, they're actually saying I don't feel safe enough. There's not enough safety. So it's not because of the price that they're not buying. It's because they're scared. There's a fear. Either there's a fear that what you offer is actually life-changing in a positive way, right? But it's change. And it could be that they don't know you enough. So again, reflecting for yourself, any time when you have said, I can't afford it, but actually you meant, I'm scared. I don't feel safe enough yet. So it's a red herring, the price thing. Don't be taken in by that smelly red herring. Here's the really important bit. If someone doesn't feel safe, one of the worst things you could do is actually to drop your price, because it removes safety. I know it sounds counter-instinctive, but it looks like you don't really know what you're doing. It looks like you're not really clear on the value. You haven't made a clear decision. One of the strongest ways to increase safety, to really increase that feeling of reassurance and spaciousness, is to stick with your price. Your price is your price is your price. It's ironic, right? Because you think, oh, drop them makes people feel safe. But actually, don't get tricked. Don't swim in the opposite direction from what's going to create that safety. And one way to increase that safety is to increase the KLT factor. You might know what this means, the know, like, and trust factor. Okay, the more you can help people to get to know you, to like you, and to trust you, the safer it's going to feel for them to do business with you. So you can do this by becoming more visible. So if I were to type your name into Google, what would I find? Would I be able to find lots of examples of your expertise, lots of people saying that they loved having your support? Would I really be able to get a feel for you and feel like if I were to do business with you, it would be like doing business with a friend? It would be like getting to know you that well. So let's sum up where we've been so far. I find that healthy pricing really is not about the economy, because at all times, some people will be spending lots of money and lots of people will have some money to spend. And when you're offering what they need, it makes sense that they'll spend it with you. I also find that healthy pricing is not about worth. It's not about self-worth. It's even not about worth to the other person. It's different. Remember that image, that money is flowing through them to you just as your gifts are flowing through you to them. And we're in relationship because of this. And people are more likely to pay when they have this sense of relationship with us. So then what is healthy pricing about? For me, in my experience, it's about being in connection with our community, with our ideal clients, so that we can really deeply hear their needs. We can hear the stories that they're wanting to tell and meet them in the telling of those stories. We can play with responding to their needs. We can ask questions, we can be in conversation, we can come to be known and liked and trusted by them so they feel our heart, they feel our integrity, they feel our authentic yearning to serve them. And healthy pricing is also then about being in communication. So regularly communicating with that community, sharing value, showing your expertise, showing ourselves to be trustworthy. We can build safety through those communications. And we can do both this connection and this communication through content marketing. So by that, we mean sharing content with our community freely in ways so that it works as marketing. It works to inspire them to want to take the next step and become our paying clients. And for many people, and probably for most people even on this webinar, content marketing is the missing piece. So in my experience, time and time again, I see that without content marketing, it's very hard to take your business to the next level. On the other hand, when you build a relationship, when you share content, people then feel like they're doing business with a friend when they buy from you. And as you may have spotted, when it comes to content marketing, my big passion is blogging. So if you haven't ever read a blog on my site, then here's an idea of what it looks like. Here's a screenshot from my website, which is youinspireme.co.uk. Do come over and have a read of some of the blogs if you haven't already. You can see there's 93 comments on that blog. And, you know, you might have been dabbling with blogging and you're thinking, oh my gosh, how do you get that kind of engagement? Because it's not only engagement, but that the engagement actually leads directly to clients and it leads directly to income. And over the years, blogging has been my number one way of marketing. And it's what's made it far easier for me to set really healthy prices. When I was doing a lot of one-to-one coaching work and charging £1,500, you know, for each person, people would pay repeatedly that amount over and over again without ever having met me because they read my blog. And this is what I want for you, this kind of experience. I have seen that blogging is a really wonderful antidote to struggle around pricing. And I think it's for two main reasons. It's because firstly, you really know that you're meeting a need. Because you hear from people in the comment section of your blog and they'll tell you what they want to pay you for. And so you then just offer what it is that they're asking for. And the second reason I think blogging is a wonderful antidote to pricing struggle is because then you won't be distracted. When someone says to you, I can't afford it, you're not going to feel guilty like you're letting them down. You're letting them walk away empty-handed because they're not. They can get lots of free stuff on your website. So everybody's being taken care of, but you don't have to drop your prices to make it affordable for everybody. Let me know if this is landing, if this is kind of making sense. So you might have spotted that I am offering these webinars this week about pricing in the week that I'm opening enrollment on the Blog for Clients course. And so if you saw that and you didn't quite see the connection, just let me know, is it now making sense? That healthy pricing, from where I'm coming from, this is my kind of position in the world of marketing, healthy pricing is built on the foundation of content marketing. Okay, so you're giving stuff for free and giving people the inspiration to actually become your paying clients. Just going to see what some of you have been saying. Yeah, great. Fantastic. Nicola's stepping up to blogging. Fantastic. The response is being really good and people are relating to the story I'm telling. Congratulations, Nicola. Wonderful. Great. So the questions that you have, please save them. We're going to get to the question bit at the end. Just copy and paste them at the end. We'll try and get to them there. Yeah, I'm not sure how you say your name. I'm sorry, but it's Shwetan. It's saying that dropping the price after a rejection makes you feel really cheap. And when that fails to land the job double rejection just kills. It can destroy self-confidence. Yeah, really amazing. Oh, good. Okay, people are saying, yeah, I get it, Ian. Hey, Ian, I get it. It's making sense. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, my freebies would be content marketing. Absolutely. Great. Fiona's having lots of ideas popping into your head. Fantastic. Great. Jane used to blog regularly, but hasn't done a lot in the last 9 months. Yeah, really, consistency is so key, Jane. So I hope you find your way back to it. Yeah, Marie's saying, I noticed you write just once per week on your blog. Is that really enough? Absolutely. I used to actually only do it every 2 weeks. You'll see on the course I actually teach how often you should blog, and I'll say that every two weeks was absolutely fine for me. I only stepped it up in the last year or so. It's absolutely enough. Okay, great. Suzanne's saying, I haven't really seen it this way up to now. Great. And your question, Suzanne, about how to get people to read my blog, that is exactly what I'm going to let you know about a little bit more now. So I'm going to take a few minutes now to let you know why the Blog for Clients course exists, why it was created, and then we'll head to questions in the final minutes. So this course is not going to be for everybody on this webinar. You know, if you're already full with clients, if you're already perfectly well known in your field and you're finding lots of outlets to express yourself, just hang in there. We're going to get to questions at the end and people's comments. They're really interesting to hear what other people are commenting on. So just hang with us and stay till then. But for others on this webinar, this course will be coming at the perfect time and you'll be feeling that sense of, oh yeah, this is maybe what has been missing for me. Because maybe you'll be really aware that you're working harder than you need to with your marketing. You know, you're struggling with your pricing and you just want this whole thing to get easier. You want to be known, as Suzanne says, you want to get people actually reading your blog, coming to your website. And this is the reason that I created this course. It's because my colleagues started, I actually remember specifically a coach called Catherine found me in the loo at a coaching event. And she said, you make marketing look so easy. You make blogging look so easy. Could you please teach me how to do it? And I said, really? People want to learn that? And she said, yes. Oh my gosh. You have no idea how much we don't know how to do this. And over time, she and lots of other people have explained, you know, how it feels to be invisible or to want to blog but not know what to write about and stare at a blank screen and wonder what on earth to write and how on earth to get people to read what it is you're writing. And people always saying as well that pricing wasn't coming easily because there was no kind of way of giving stuff for free. So then people feeling they had to give their core product away for free and not feeling like their marketing was based on this firm foundation. So you can take a look at the course. You can find that image of that gorgeous woman with the computer on the right-hand side of my website. So if you go to youinspireme.co.uk.
And that is where I'm going to take you right now. So this is where I bring up the website. I want to just check in with, wonderful, fantastic. It's been so lovely to read your comments as we've been going through this and seeing what it is that you guys are taking from this training. And I've made a note of your question, Ellie, and also your question, Anne. I'm going to be answering them towards the end there. Let me just see the last few things you've said. Fantastic. Wonderful. So we'll take a look at this page. Remember, if it's just not the right time for you for this training, make yourself a cup of tea, hang out, and we're going to get to questions and hopefully these demos actually taking you through some of these exercises right at the end. That's my intention. So we're here, we're at youinspireme.co.uk, and you find this lovely icon here. And if you scroll through, there's a few places I want to take you to. So first of all, if you haven't seen the page, this is what it looks like. These are the beautiful illustrations that I was talking about that Joe has made. And the content, this is what I want to look at first, the content, so you really know what it is you're getting on this journey. So in the very first week, you're going to be generating a whole year's worth of blog content. And this isn't just blog content, it's the kind of content that you enjoy writing about. And it's the kind of content that your ideal client really wants to read. So even if you think they're busy, they don't have time to read blogs, you're going to be discovering how to stand out in their inbox. So they can't wait to click and read. And the way I see it is like you become an oasis in the desert for them. And it's all well and good to write interesting blogs, but actually selling, this is what we're going to be looking at, how to seamlessly integrate sales invitations without sounding salesy. I'm going to be talking through seeding and calls to action and why you don't need to hard sell. So your blogs are strategic, but they don't feel in any way forced or manipulative or like it's just about selling. It's just going to feel so natural and so easy that people are going to want to take the next step with you. And then you do the actual writing. So this is in week two. We look at the proven method for overcoming blank screen syndrome and getting your blog draft written in 30 minutes. You do this with loads of support around you. You're getting feedback from your fellow participants. And we also have in week four, so once you've written a blog, hopefully a second blog, in week four, we have a 90-minute live Q&A feedback call. So I'll be inviting you, this is new for 2015. I'll be inviting you to submit your blog to me so that I can read your wonderful words. And then in that Q&A feedback call, I'll be able to share insights that I picked up on from reading the blogs. And any questions that you've had that haven't been answered on a daily basis through the learning site, that's where I can answer any of them in more detail as well. So you're doing the actual writing in a really safe place. You get to experiment. I walk you through step by step so it works. So your blogging works. People want to read it. And the feedback that I love to hear is, wow, it's actually fun to write blogs now. Whereas before it was like a chore or something that you felt you had to do. Then we also look at what to name your blog. So here we go, the pitfalls to avoid when naming your blogs and how you choose blog titles that are good for SEO as well, okay? And that actually people want to read. Because people's inboxes are busy, people are busy on social media. How do you stand out in those places and inspire people to click and read your blog? And then once the blog is written, we're looking at images as well, how you include images, some of the key things in terms of links that you include, lots and lots of detailed content. In week 5, we look then at what do you do if people aren't reading? So how do you bring more readers over to your blog? Because one of the most common reasons why I've seen people stop writing blogs is because they feel like nobody's reading or nobody's commenting. So it's kind of like talking to thin air. So you'll learn how blogging fits with your email list, and we'll go into detail about how you set that up and how you interact with your email list in terms of your blog, and also with social media as well. So you're getting a full understanding of how it all works together. If questions come up for you about the content, do let me know and I can answer them along with the other questions that I've made a note of as well. So it's a 6-week course. So you actually get your first 3 or more blogs written within the structure and support of the course. And it's an online course. So you can find out more about this in the How the Learning Takes Place section. Okay, you're actually learning about blogging from within a blog. It's a private training blog. It's password protected. It's private. And modules are released there on the Monday, Wednesday, and Friday of all 4 content weeks. You've got all of these details on the site, so I'm taking you to the page so that you can take a look at this. It means that you can basically access the learning whenever suits you and wherever you are. So we've had people from Canada, from Switzerland, from all across the UK, from Europe. It's a really thriving online community. So we have our main learning site, and then we also have a separate private members-only Facebook group. And that's open to everybody who's taken the course before as well. So people are still interacting. Even now, people are still interacting from a year or 2 ago. They're still getting feedback. And what I've discovered is that even if you didn't want to learn how to blog, you would get really amazing networking by being part of this community. So the really good news for you being here today is that we are now open for enrollment. So the course starts on the 12th of January. We're open right now, so you can come to this page right now. You can book your place. And by enrolling as soon as you know you want to join, you get lots of time to settle into the pre-course material. There's some really useful resources that you get straight away. So if you know you want to join, do come and book your place. And you'll see that if you are wanting to spread the payments, so if you would rather pay in 3 installments, the 3 installment option closes on Friday at 5 p.m. After that, it's just the 1 and 2 installment options that are available there. So the price is $495. And this is where you get to practice what we've been looking at today. So if you notice yourself going, oh, I really want to take this course, but I can't afford it, we get to practice. We get to practice right now what we've been looking at. So just smile if that thought came to your mind and just see if any of these translations might apply. So number 1, if it's not a priority. So again, maybe you have plenty of clients or you've decided to do something other than blogging to become better known. Fantastic. Just be truthful. It's not that you can't afford it. It's that you don't want to join. And that's a really powerful position. Or second translation, it could be that you haven't yet been communicated to about the value of blogging or of this course. So please let me know. You know, it might be that you're new to this work. You might have missed the love story that I've been telling about blogging for however many years now. So there are lots of blogs and videos and emails I've written about the power of blogging. And all the information about this course, of course, is on the website. And what you can do is you can come through. Oh, this is really important as well. This is, in fact, let me just pause because this is really super important. We're doing one free rejoin for anybody who joins us in January. You get to retake this course again for free at a time of your choosing in the future. And why we've done this is so that, you know, life happens. It might be that you say, yeah, I want to do it in January. And then something happens. Someone falls ill. You get an amazing opportunity. You suddenly want to travel. Something happens and you just aren't as focused as you want to be. Or there's so much good content you want to, you know, you didn't quite dig into it all. Doesn't matter at all. You don't have to wait for life to pause because you get to take it in January and then you get to come back and take it again in the future. And it's always evolving. So you get two versions of the course and you get all the upgrades as well. So please don't think, oh, I've got to wait until time is perfect, because in our experience, that just doesn't really happen. We get to just make the time be perfect and you've got the free rejoin if you want it. Going back to the value piece, what's really useful in this, again, to think about you with your own clients is to look at other people's experience. So on the page, you can read so many people's stories. There's Katie, there's Jan, there's Lisa, there's Juicy. You can just read all these people, the value. There's Jennifer, who's actually here on this call. Hey, Jennifer. You can just go through and read what was their experience of the value of blogging and the value of this course. You can read through. They just go on and on, on and on and on. And then the third reason is maybe because you don't feel safe. So it's, you know, it can be scary to think about becoming visible, to be blogging, to be out there and sharing your words. You know, lots of people actually you'll see in here, people have been nervous. People have been worried about becoming visible and sharing their opinions, sharing their thoughts. So please know that that's really normal. And in terms of safety, how I can convey safety as well as the people's stories here that you can read. Let's just go right down. Look how many. We have a wise investment guarantee. So this is the ultimate kind of safety here, is that if you reach the end of the training and you don't think I delivered what I said I would deliver, then you can, there's some conditions there, just read them and you can receive your money back. So this is for you to think about. How can you create this for your own community, for your own clients? How can you create this sense of safety so that the I can't afford it thing is not really, we can kind of clear that red herring out of the way. And if you don't feel safe because you have questions, please type them in now. We can see how many questions we can get to now before we go to the final bit where I want to give one or two of you the opportunity to actually practice some of this stuff we've been looking at today. Okay, great. Emma, I'll make a note of your question as well. And while we're waiting for a few more questions to come in as well, let me just check if there's anything else I wanted you to know about this. Let me just take a scroll back. We've got the free rejoin. We've also got a buddy system. So you can opt into that. You can be buddied with someone from the course once a week, so you can actually have a chat with them. It's very much not a home study. I'm really interactive every single day on the community forum. I'm interactive and we have the live Q&A and you can have a buddy and you've got Facebook. I'll come back up here. Yeah, wonderful. Okay, let's see other questions that have been coming in. And if you don't get your question answered today, you can send it to yes@youinspireme.co.uk. Okay, perfect. So we've got Ellie's question, Anne's question, Emma's question, and then let's see if we can do a demo. So Ellie, I'm going to bring your line up if you're happy with that. Just speak. If you're not, just don't speak. So hey, Ellie, can you hear me?
Hello.
Hey, great to hear you.
Hello.
You asked a question about student discounts. Do you want to say a little bit more about that?
Yes, absolutely. I have been working well.
It's just worth mentioning for anybody who speaks, just be aware that this is being recorded. So to know that you are going down for posterity.
Great.
Great.
I'm a yoga teacher, and I've been working with quite a number of students for quite a while now. So my question is really about postgrad students as opposed to undergrad students. So they're people who don't have so much money coming in perhaps from home, and they're reliant on quite a small income. And I am wondering what your thoughts are about offering any kind of discounts to students in this context, where I have a group of postgrad students who are very, very loyal students and very loyal customers. And how do I meet that need?
Great question. And what is your regular pricing?
Well, it's all changing now since I've just done Passion to Profit and so on. But at the moment, for a one-hour class, I would be expecting to charge £10. But some of them have come from classes which have been subsidised by the university, so they have been paying as little as £3. I would be expecting to charge £10 for an hour for a group session.
Great. So a few things I'll just kind of speak as my kind of intuition leads me to here. One thing is that all of us can make assumptions about certain groups. So what I hear often is things like mothers, XYZ, students, XYZ, older people, XYZ, and they're not always true. So there's definitely an assumption there that the postgrad students have less money than others. And I would just be curious if that is definitely true.
They like to tell me it's true. Yeah. Whether that is entirely correct or their sort of feeling about their situation, I'm not sure. But I really don't know what a postgrad student has as an income, to be honest, so I can't give you a concrete figure. But they do say now and again about, you know, needing to be conscious, not necessarily in relation to what I do particularly, but that their incomes are not huge.
In my experience, people will say I can't afford it, or they'll say we're a particular income group, and then I see that they're spending money elsewhere quite happily. And I guess my stand is that we as business owners, we have tremendous business costs. We have often put a huge amount of money into our own training and continued training. And I'm really passionate about this. I really want to see us receiving money that's fair. It's like I've seen this so often that I'll give you an example. Someone paid a lot of money to hire a venue and then paid very little money to the speakers because they could kind of get away with it, whereas the venue wouldn't possibly dream of giving a discount that was for an event. And I just might see that as well, that maybe a student would be perfectly happy to pay for a holiday or for a car, or I don't know, you know, whatever it is. But £10 for a yoga session, that sounds reasonable to me. That sounds like that's money that you can find. It's just about prioritising that. And I feel passionate that if we as our industries stay firm about this, it's like the Apple example. You can't go into an Apple store. I mean, students do get a discount in an Apple store. That is true. But there's a sense that if as an industry we hold firm on certain prices, then that's just what's accepted. And we're fair to ourselves.
It's as I move forward to now doing with this webinar, but also the finishing the Passion to Profit, I certainly am looking to be offering, rather than drop-in sessions, much more of a course where people are paying a greater sum of money. And I suppose my fear is that students who have been very loyal to me for, you know, a number of years and who I love to teach are going to struggle. And I'm not sure if I need to meet their needs or at all, whether to consider them or just go for what feels right in terms of sort of a more general price.
Yeah, and again, just, you know, are they actually going to struggle, or is it just that it's going to be a change, but once they get used to it, it's perfectly fine? You know, certainly in Cambridge, I see such a variety in yoga prices, and people pay the highest ones in the area, and likewise in London. I've seen people paying that. There's a really interesting suggestion here from Anne. Anne's saying, have you thought of asking them for something in return? You mentioned they're very loyal. Could they get a discount for referring? And she's referring to like the Dropbox model. So Dropbox is a company, you get you get more storage space if you refer people. And that might be an idea, that it's not that there's a discount, but that there's something in return. Or, you know, what I've seen with Five Rhythms classes in Cambridge. So I think Five Rhythms classes tend to be £12 in Cambridge. I'm not sure what they would be in London. And I've seen if people can't afford that, then there's the option to volunteer, to set up the room, to clear down the room. I would be interested in that kind of a model as well. Okay, so you're a student, so perhaps, and again, I'm not convinced, but perhaps you can't afford this. Again, I'm going to use that phrase. Perhaps you feel you can't afford it, or perhaps whatever. But is there something you can do in exchange? You know, they could hand out flyers if they're loyal. They could help with the room. They could get there 5 minutes earlier to make you a cup of tea. I don't know, something that they're kind of replacing money with time.
And also the one thing that I did consider is, if I'm going to offer any discount, or any system as you're discussing, I would limit it to a small number. So there is only X number in a group of 10. There's a very small proportion who may get that option. So it's not like it's a free-for-all.
Yeah, great. And what I would also say is, in terms of resonant pricing, it all comes back to that, and to pricing from that place of stillness. Because if you sit with your resonant pricing and you come to two numbers, not from a place of fear or of, oh, I don't want to lose them, or they can't afford it. But if you genuinely sit there and you find, oh, £10 and I've also got this other number, then maybe you're just being shown that that other number is the resonant price for this particular group.
Yeah.
But it's a preemptive, it's a setting of a price. It's not dropping it out of fear that they'll say no, because that's not the reason to change a price for.
And I think the other thing that you demonstrate is that you can offer installments, can't you? So if it's a quite a big chunky bit of money for a course, you can offer it over the, you know, they can pay over the course of some time.
Absolutely. And Anne's got another great suggestion for you. She's saying maybe you have a price for a long-term student, they get a reward for staying with you longer. So again, I've seen that often with yoga, X per session, but if you buy 10, if you buy 8, then there's a different price. Again, it's a resonant price for that particular way of packaging what you do.
Yeah, that might be a way to approach it, so that loyal students have an advantage, perhaps. Yeah, that's, I like Anne. She sounds great.
Great. Thank you so much for your question. I really felt that was going to be very helpful for many people listening. So thank you for speaking.
Thank you, Karina. Thanks very much.
Pleasure. Great to have you here. Let's go then to Anne. Anne, who is liked by Ellie and has had some very, very helpful suggestions. Anne, we'll come to your question about your community. Let me bring your line off. Again, if you don't want to speak, please just don't. But otherwise, you can speak. Can you hear me, Anne? Hey, Anne. Hello. Can you hear me?
Hi, Karina.
Yes, hey. I can. Thank you.
Wonderful for your helpful suggestions to Ellie. And just very conveniently, you were next in line with your question.
Oh, good.
So tell me what you were asking about community.
Oh, I've asked so many. So let me go back up.
I can read it for you and then you can just say more. You said, how can you use your community to increase your know, like and trust factor?
Yeah, because to me, so I do agree completely that people tell you they're not sure about paying that. So I offer a diary system. And a lot of people, they are starting in business, they are not sure how much money they're going to make, they are just taking the leap, and they're thinking, do I need this? Don't I need this? I'm not sure. Is this too much money? And what I've seen time and time again is that if they do take the leap, and the system really helps them, and fills their diary gets fuller quicker than if they didn't have it. But it's getting the trust that it will do this. It's really hard to do. And I wondered how I could use the existing users and the people in the community to help reassure them that it's going to be okay.
Yeah, it's such a good question. I have three suggestions for you. One is around testimonials. So you may well already have these, just that you have on your site stories that you're sharing about people's experience. And what I would be looking to include in those testimonials are the doubts that they had originally. So often you'll see testimonials are just, oh my gosh, Anne's service was amazing. That's not actually going to speak to the doubts in the prospective client as much as if that testimonial said, I wasn't sure about signing up with 10 to 8 because I didn't know if my business was at the level yet. I didn't know if I had enough clients to make it worth it. Could I just manage without it? However, I took the leap and I'm so glad I did because. So when, and this is for everybody, of course, when you're asking for testimonials, to ask the person, the happy client, to ask them, what were your doubts, hesitations, and reluctance about signing up for this? Is that new or is that something that you were doing already?
And often when you do ask people, you don't want to ask this because you want them to have forgotten it.
Well, actually, yeah, it's actually often really lovely for them to go, oh my gosh, I was really reluctant. Thank goodness I got over myself. Thank goodness I took the leap. So please don't be scared about asking people that, because once they've been your happy client, you know, those doubts will have been reassured by the fact that they've loved having your service.
Yeah, thank you.
So that's the first thing. And testimonials, not only on your website, but you can actually put those testimonials on, for example, social media, or for example, on a blog, not or, and. So you'll see the blog that went out today, for example, we've got a testimonial from someone on the blog about the Blog for Clients course. So you can make those visual, you can put them in your blog, and you can also, as again, you'll see that I share them on social media. So you get your testimonials and you can share them in these places. And then the other two places that your community can be talking about you and importantly to each other. That's really the key when it comes to inspiring your community to do the work for you, is encouraging them to speak to each other in your blog comments and on your social media platforms to each other. Is that useful?
Yeah, that's really useful. Thanks. I think that's one thing we're really still struggling. We got quite a big community, and but they don't talk to each other enough. Mm. And it's really a shame because they could all benefit from each other's services as well.
Yeah. And how are you, Anne, with holding firm on prices? If someone said I can't afford it, are you rock solid or would you waver a little bit?
Well, there's for very small for people who are on their own, the price of the system is it's £15 a month, and you go online, you download it online, and you pay. I don't get involved in this, so I don't really talk about that price, so I don't have to be firm.
Mm-hmm.
The only prices I have to make up are for larger companies. And I don't mind charging them so much.
Okay.
So I'm glad I have to kind of talk to the smaller guys.
Yeah.
Because I would stay firm.
I'll pause you there. Because what I'm wanting to do is I'm wanting to do a demo with one person who is maybe not yet feeling solid on their price. So I'm going to go look for that person. Thank you so much for asking your question. It was really a useful question.
Thanks, Karina.
So let's just see, please. Just type in if you would be happy to do a very quick demo with me. I want you to get a chance to practice how to handle when someone says, I can't afford it. I want someone to actually have an experience of this and the others, if you can hear what it's like when someone says, I can't afford it. Let's just see if any of you are going to type this in. I'm very gentle. Don't worry. It won't hurt. In fact, it will be amazing. You'll come away. When I did this the other day, someone just, you know, had that experience of it. Okay, wonderful. I'll come back to you, Ellie, then. So, Ellie, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, fantastic. So, what's the price that you feel that you might waver on if someone said, I can't afford it?
So I'm developing a new course for learning how to do your own yoga practice at home with support and guidance from me. And I, just in this webinar, priced it at £300 and had a massive wobble because that sounds an enormous amount of money.
Wonderful. So just remembering that sense of stillness from the beginning, that £300, it can just have that purity and that clarity and that stillness of a fact. That this is just the price, just like you were telling me what colour hair you have. What colour hair do you have?
I have blonde hair.
And what's the price of your offering?
£300.
Mm-hmm. So what we want, and this is for everybody, we want for the answers to be the same. Like it's like there's no apology, there's no defending, there's no justifying. It's just the price is the price is the price. So I'm going to tell you that I can't afford it. And what I invite you to play with is the empathy for that. And the firmness, that it's like someone saying to you, Ellie, I don't like your hair. I don't like the fact that you have blonde hair.
So you... my response to that will screw you.
Yeah. Perfect. So you might have the same response with a prospective client. And so here's what, for me, it would sound like something like, I hear that and it's £300. And that there would just be this silence, right? There's nothing really more to say because like, yeah, that's, I have blonde hair. That's the end of the information here. Yeah. So I'm gonna come at you with the best I've got, okay?
Okay.
And find that anchoring, find that stillness of your breath, feeling the gravity, you're unconditionally safe. It doesn't matter if they say yes or no, you're just stating a fact.
Okay.
So how much is this this thing you're offering, Ellie? Remind me what it's called again.
I'm going to be calling it Progress Your Practice.
Wonderful. And I'm really interested in it. I really want to develop my own yoga practice. So what's the price?
The price for it is £300.
How much?
£300.
£300?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh, that's so expensive.
For the content and for my experience, no, it's not so expensive. It's just £300.
So I really, gosh, I mean, I really, really want to do it. And I just, I mean, what's the best deal that you can do?
There are no deals as such. You can break it down in the sense that you can pay for it over the course of a period of time. So you can pay in installments. I have that all set up. But in total, it does cost £300.
I've got to pause. I am loving this. I don't know what everyone else is hearing, but my experience of receiving your solidness is I just feel so safe. I just feel like I'm being respected. That's what I feel like you're just completely with me, you're completely clear, you're building an incredible amount of trust in me. What's it like for you?
I feel like I'm watching you have a bit of a tantrum, but I'm not getting involved.
Yeah, great. It's exactly what it feels. I'm going to throw one more thing at you, okay? Ellie, please, you've got to help me here. I really want to do this. I'm just desperate for yoga. You know, yoga should be free. It's like people have been doing this for so many centuries. This is what people need. This is not a luxury product. I really need it. My partner has just left me. Yoga is the only thing that keeps me going. Could you please give me a discount?
For this course, no, as I say, because of the content of it, and I've got a considerable amount of experience in all of this, so no, that's the price of the course. However, there are freebies on my website, so there's some blog posts, there's a few videos, so if you need some free stuff right now, that's definitely the place to go. I'm really happy to take your money in installments, but the price is the price.
I love you. That was amazing. That was, and I love that. I love the fact that you didn't give my tantrum anywhere to go. You made it really, really clear for me. I was able to know where I stood with you. And in that time of need, if I was imagining myself really in that time of need, then you gave me a really safe place to kind of fall. Thank you. That was amazing.
other aspect of it is that if you're in that kind of place, that perhaps actually it's not right for you to sign up for that at that moment anyway. So there's the standing firm also perhaps helps with that, so that if you were in that kind of state, actually to sign up to a course, it may not be the right thing anyway. So, you know, some freedom to bring you in might be better.
Amazing. And you've had a lot of people commenting, wow, that girl is good, etc. So people are loving it. And I would say, I would absolutely encourage you to apply the same principle, have someone else kind of come at you as being a postgraduate student and see the stillness that you can hold there as well. And for everybody as well listening, to practice this is so important, to practice this stuff. So I'm going to just share with you the link to this, the course, if you want more on how to, like Ellie said, Madeline, can you just type in for me? If like Ellie said, you want to be able to give someone a link to your free stuff rather than giving them a discount, then do check out the Blog for Clients course. I'm going to just drop the link in. You've seen it there on the screen. But I would love to welcome you to this so that you can get connecting with your community, inspire them to buy from you without you having to do the discounting thing. Be wonderful to see you there. Please type in what it is you are taking from our time together. Thank you so much for being here, for your amazing contributions, for what you're sharing and what you're doing just generally in the world. I've loved finding out a bit about your businesses. And just type that in. We are open for the Blog for Clients course, so I look forward to spending time with those of you who are joining us over there. And for the remainder here, I just wish you the very, very best with your path of self-employment. May it be happy, may it be profitable, may you help people and also take care of yourself as well. And I wish you a very, very peaceful and happy rest of your week. Goodbye for now.